Myself, Shri Balaji, Assistant Professor in the Department of Management Studies, Bharat Institute of Higher Education and Research. The topic is about business ethics, corporate social responsibilities, and governance. Features of Indian culture. There are four types of features in Indian culture. One is longevity and continuity. Second, unity in diversity. Third, tolerance. Fourth, amalgamation of spirituality and materialism. Political setup, major characteristics and their implications for business. Directive principles of state policy. The directive principles of state policy, which have been enshrined in part 4 of the constitution, aim at realizing the high ideals of justice, liberty, equality and fraternity as outlined in the preamble to the constitution. There are ideas which are to inspire the state to work for the common good of the people and establish social and economic democracy in the country. The phrase directive principles of state policy means the principles which the states should keep in mind while framing the laws and formulating policy. Articles 39 to 51 contain various directive principles. These principles are amalgamation of socialistic, Gandhian and liberal principles. Economic importance. The economic importance of directive principles of state policy is to provide adequate means of livelihood for all the citizens, to secure equal pay for work to both men and women, to protect the workers, especially children, to regulate the economic system of the country that it does not lead to concentration of wealth and means of production, to make provision for securing right to work, to education and to public assistance in case of unemployment, old age, sickness and similar other cases, to ensure a decent standard of living and facilities of leisure for all workers. The main objective of the above noted directive principles are to enable the individual to lead a good and satisfying life. All the provisions of directive principles of state policy guide the government policies towards the business and other economic and social activities. The government also so far enacted a number of acts and laws, policies and rules keeping in view the directive principles, which are directly related with the business operations. The various acts like FERA, Factory Act, MRTP Act, Minimum Wages Act, Industrial Development and Regulation Act, industrial policy are based on the directive principles of the Constitution. Socio-cultural environment and the impact on business operations. Businesses do not exist in a vacuum, and even the most successful business must be aware of changes in the cultural and societies in which it does business. As society and culture change, businesses must adapt to stay ahead of their competitors and stay relevant in the minds of their consumers. Changing preferences. A major socio-cultural factor influencing business and business decisions is changing consumer preferences. What was popular and fashionable 20 years ago may not be popular today or 10 years down the road. Different styles and priorities can undermine long successful products and services. For example, a clothing company must constantly be aware of changing preferences when creating new products, or it will quickly become outdated. Demographics. Changes in demographics are also a significant factor in the business world. As population ages, for example, markets for popular music and fashions may shrink, while markets for luxury goods and health products may increase. Additionally, changes in the proportion of genders and different racial, religious, and ethnic groups within a society also have a significant impact on the way a company does business. Advertising techniques. Advertising is perhaps the area of business most closely in touch with socio-cultural changes. Advertising often seeks to be hip and trend-setting, and to do this, advertising agencies and departments cannot lose track of the pulse of the societies in which they engage in business. Changes in morals, values, and fashions must all be considered when creating outward-facing advertising. Internal environment. In addition to a company's interactions with the market and its customers, socio-cultural factors also impact a company's internal decision-making process. For example, changing gender roles and increasing emphasis on family life have led to increased respect for maternity and even paternity leave with organizations. Additionally, attitudes towards racial discrimination and sexual harassment have changed drastically over the years as a result of socio-cultural change. Preamble of Constitution and Business. The Indian Constitution starts with a preamble, which outlines the main objective of the Constitution. It may be noted that though the preamble is not a part of the Constitution and is not justifiable, yet its significance cannot be denied. It serves as a key to the Constitution. Whenever the judiciary is in doubt about any particular provision of the Constitution, it refers to the preamble to find out the real intentions of the framers of the Constitution. The preamble reads, "We, the people of India, have solemnly resolved to constitute India into a sovereign, socialist and secular democratic republic, and to secure to all its citizens justice, social, economic, and political liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith, and worship, equality of status and of opportunity, and to promote among them our fraternity, assuring the dignity of the individual and the unity and integrity of the nation." In our Constituent Assembly, this 26th day of November 1949, we do hereby adopt, enact, and give to ourselves this Constitution. A perusal of the preamble shows it intends India to be a sovereign, socialist, secular, and democratic republic. It means that like other state, India is a sovereign state and is free to conduct its internal as well as external relations as it deems desirable. The terms socialist and secular were added by the 42nd Amendment and assert that the government must adopt socialistic policies to ensure decent life for all Indian citizens. The inclusion of word secular likewise emphasizes that the state must abstain from giving preferential treatment to any religion. Democratic government implies the government is to be carried on by the elected representatives of the people. And the government stays in office as long as it enjoys the confidence of their elected representatives. Republic implies that the highest executive authority in India shall vest in a person directly elected by the people. In other words, there is no place for monarchical or feudal system in India. Economic importance. The preamble of the Indian Constitution guarantees to its every citizen. Economic justice. The Indian Constitution laid down social, economic, and political justice to every citizen in the country. It is therefore the duty of the business organizations to provide social, economic, and political justice to every citizen. Liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith, and worship. This is being accepted in our constitution that every citizen has liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith, and worship. According to this concern, every business organization should have liberty of thought, expression, so on with everyone. Equality of status and of opportunity. According to this concern, every businessman should believe and give equal opportunity to others. This can be achieved through eradication of poverty. This does not mean winning gap between the poor and rich. Features of economic planning. The real beginning of planning in India was made in March 1950 when the Planning Commission was established. In July 1951, the Planning Commission of India submitted its draft outline of the first five-year plan to be effective from 1951 to 52 and to 1955. The main features of India's five-year plans. The following are some of the salient features of India's five-year plans. Totally democratic. The first and foremost important feature of Indian planning is that it is totally democratic. Decentralized planning. Decentralized planning is another feature of Indian planning, which aims at achieving active participation of the people in the planning process. Directed by Central Planning Authority. Another important feature of Indian planning is that a central planning authority directs it. That is, the Planning Commission of India plays the role of regulatory mechanism so as to provide necessary direction and regulation over the planning process. There is coexistence of central planning and state planning. Periodic plan. Another important feature of Indian planning is the adoption of a periodic plan of 5 year period have 5 separate annual plan components. In each plan, a separate outlay is earmarked both for the public sector and the private sector. Guided by basic objectives. One of the important features of Indian planning is that each and every plan is guided by basic objectives. which are almost common in most of our plans. Balanced regional development. Another salient feature of India's 5-year plan is that it constantly attaches much importance on balanced regional development. Perspective planning. Indian planning has adopted the system of perspective planning for some basic issues or problems of the country. Indian planning system is broadly supported by program implementation and evaluation machinery, which used to play a very important role. Another notable feature of Indian 5-year plan is its shortfalls in target realization leads to the problem of spill over the projects into next 5-year plans. 5-year plans in India determine the priorities of development, keeping in mind the needs of the country. Role and advantages of Chamber of Commerce. A Chamber of Commerce, also referred to in some circles as a Board of Trade, is a form of business network. Example, a local organization of business whose goal is to further the interests of business. Business owners in towns and cities from these local societies to advocate on behalf of the business community. Chambers of Commerce plays a vital role by rendering useful services to businessmen and the government. Services to businessmen, Chambers of Commerce serves as friends, philosophers, and guides to the business community. Businessmen derive the following advantages from Chambers of Commerce. Businessmen get valuable information free of cost. They can expand their business activities with the help of suggestions and advice from Chamber of Commerce. Chambers of Commerce creates markets for the products of the members by organizing fairs and exhibitions. Businessmen get a common forum at which they can discuss problems and exchange views of matters of common interest. Differences and disputes among businessmen can be solved amicably and economically with the help of Chamber of Commerce. Members take advantage of educational and training facilities offered by Chamber of Commerce. Chamber of Commerce undertakes research on behalf of their members. Chambers of Commerce fosters a sense of cooperation among businessmen. Chambers of Commerce in India. In India, Chambers of Commerce have been organized at both regional and national levels. Regional Chambers of Commerce. Indian Chamber of Commerce located in Kolkata. Bengal Chamber of Commerce located in Kolkata. Indian Merchants Chamber located in Mumbai. Marwari Chamber of Commerce located in Mumbai. Madras Chamber of Commerce located in Chennai. Punjab, Haryana, and Delhi Chamber of Commerce located in New Delhi. National Chambers of Commerce. Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industry, FICCI. Confederation of Indian Industry, CII. Associated Chambers of Commerce and Industry, ASSOCHAM. All India Organizations of Employees, AIOE. FICCI. The Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industry, FICCI, were established in 1926 in New Delhi as an apex central body of businessmen in India. It consists of both individual and corporate members. Its membership consists of 50 chambers of commerce and trade associations, 200 overseas members, and 1,500 associate members. Its management is vested in an executive committee. FICCI acts as a representative body of Indian business. Role of Confederation of Indian Industries. Our primary goal is to develop Indian industry and to ensure that government and society as a whole understand both the needs of industry and its contribution to the nation's well-being. For this, we work to identify and strengthen industry's role in the economic development of the country, to act as a catalyst in bringing about the growth and development of Indian industry, to reinforce industry's commitment to society, to provide up-to-date information and data to industry and government, to create awareness and support industry's effort on equality, environment, energy management, and consumer protection, to identify and address the special needs of the small sector to make it more competitive, to promote cooperation with counterpart organizations, to work towards the globalization of Indian industry and integration into the world economy. This is done by adopting a proactive and partnership approach with the government on various national and international issues concerning the Indian economy. It closely interacts on policy issues at both the central and state levels. Extensive dialogue and interaction with members and all sections of the community to build consensus are held. Objectives of Confederation of Indian Industries. The main objective of CII are identify and strengthen industry role in the economic development of the country, act as a catalyst in bringing about growth and development of the Indian industry, reinforcement industry commitment to society, work toward globalization of Indian industry and integration into world economy, provide up-to-date information and data to industry and government, create awareness and support industry efforts on equality, environment and consumer protection, identify and address special needs of small-scale sectors, promote cooperation with counterpart organizations. Major objectives of India's new industrial policy, 1991, are with the gradual liberalization of the 1956 industrial policy in mid-80s, the tempo of industrial development started picking up, but the industry was still feeling the burden of many controls and regulations. For a faster growth of industry, it was necessary that even these impediments should be removed. The new government by Sri Narasimha Rao, which took office in June 1991, announced a package of liberalization measures under its industrial policy on July 24, 1991. The new industrial policy 1991 seeks to liberate the industry from the shackles of licensing system, drastically reduce the role of public sector, and encourage foreign participation in India's industrial development. The broad objective of new industrial policy are liberalizing the industry from the regulatory devices such as license and controls, enhancing support to the small scale sector, increasing competitiveness of industries for the benefit of the common man, ensuring running of public enterprises on business lines and thus cutting their losses, providing more incentives for industrialization of the backward areas, and ensuring rapid industrial development in a competitive environment. Rationale of planning in India. In India, comprehensive national planning is required to fulfill some broad social and economic objectives. The following are some principal reasons for planning in India. Rapid economic development. Before independence, the long period of British rule and exploitation had made India one of the poorest nations in the world. The main task before the national government was to undertake some positive development measures to initiate a process of development, which can be done effectively only through the instrument of planning. The state planning mechanism has been proved to be much superior to private market operations in bringing about it a quick transition in the less developed economies. The spectacular success of planning in some countries had inspired the national leaders to adapt the path of planning for an accelerated development of the shattered economy. Quick improvement in the standard of living. The fundamental objective of planning is to bring about a quick improvement in the standard of living of the people in the less developed countries. In an unplanned economy, the country's resources and materials cannot be employed for increasing the people's welfare as the private capitalist in such an economic direct. Their activities in increasing their own profits. The path of planning has been chosen to promote a rapid rise in the standard of living of the people by efficient exploitation of resources, increasing production of most goods and offering employment opportunities to the people. Removal of poverty. Planning in India is necessary for the yearly removal of abject poverty of the people. This can be effectively done through planned increase in the employment opportunities of the people, planned production of mass consumption goods, and the planned distribution among the people. Fulfillment of minimum needs program by providing essential facilities. Example, housing, roads, drinking water, public health, primary education, slum improvement, and planned increase in the consumption of the poorest section of the people. Rational allocation and efficient utilization of resources. India is rich in natural resources, but these resources are not fully exploited to get maximum advantages. In the unplanned economy, resources tend to be engaged in the production of these goods and services which yield maximum profits. As a result, rational allocation of resources is not possible. An unplanned economy faces frequently the problems of either shortages in some sectors or surpluses in others. But such misallocation of resources can be rectified in a planned economy in which the planning authority determines the pattern of the investment of resources. In fact, the development plans in the country are now utilized for the rational allocation of investable resources. Increasing the rate of capital formation. Planning can be raised the rate of capital formation in the less developed countries like India. The surpluses of public enterprises as found in the planned economy can be utilized for investment and capital formation. In India, The governments have been increasing the rate of capital formation through the planned investment in the construction of roads, bridges, manufacturing of machineries and transport equipment, etc. Reduction in unequal distribution of income and wealth. Income and wealth are not evenly distributed in India. As in other less developed countries, in the absence of planning, such inequality tends to increase due to growing concentration of economic resources at the hands of a few capitalists. Besides, the capitalists in the unplanned society increase their own profits by paying less to the laborers and other suppliers of raw materials. Planning can reverse this trend through the proper guidance and control of production, distribution, consumption, and investment. The development works can be so planned and so executed that the greater equality is established with the increase of income and employment. Reduction of unemployment and increase in employment opportunities. The backwardness of the different sectors of the economy accounts for the presence of widespread unemployment, both open and dispersed in the country. The rate of economic growth usually becomes low in the unplanned society. As a result, it becomes a difficult task to mitigate this serious problem without proper planning. The government can, however, increase the employment opportunities by undertaking development programs for the different sectors like agriculture, industries, social services, transport, and communications. Besides, labor-intensive development projects and job-oriented programs can be undertaken to provide relief for the problem of unemployment. Reorganization of foreign trade. Economic planning in the less developed countries can bring about fundamental changes in the foreign trade structure of such countries like India. The foreign trade structure may be reoriented from primary producing economy to the industrialized economy through proper controls of import and effective promotion of export of industrial goods. The development plans and reorganize the foreign trade structure. In India, the trade policy has been reoriented to realize some cardinal objectives such as import control and substitution, export promotion and growth of economy. Owing to such development, the trade structure is no longer regarded as colonial as it was before independence. Regional balanced development. Economic planning in India can correct the regional imbalance in development. Proper development programs may be taken for all around development of backward areas so that all the regions are sufficiently developed. More and more industries are to be set up in the less developed areas, and the plans should provide for disposal of industries. Other considerations. Indian economy requires planning for other purposes also, such as the removal of the shortage of essential goods, attainment of self-sufficiency in essential goods such as food grains, the key materials, economic self-reliance, establishment of social justice for increasing economic facilities for weaker and neglected sections of the people. The foresaid discussion points to the supreme necessity of economic planning in India. It is now fully realized that without planning, the country would not be able to intimate a process of quick economic growth.